verses 21 through 22. Jesus answered them, "Truly I tell you, if you have faith and do not doubt, not only will you have what has been done to the fig tree, but even if you say to this mountain, 'Be lifted up and thrown into the sea,' it will be done. Whatever you ask for in prayer with faith, you will receive." And our second passage is from 2 Corinthians 12, verses 6 through 10. "But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one will think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given to me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weakness, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with my weakness, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities, all for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong." May God add blessing to the reading, hearing, and living of this holy word this day.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated.
So last week we looked at the topic of why. Why do the innocent suffer? And hopefully we had some of the conversation that we had afterwards and some of the things that you heard me share were meaningful for you and gave you things to think about. So we're continuing in answering some of the questions that you shared when you turned in your cards about your doubts. And so this week we're going to be looking at prayer and the question that we often have of why our prayers don't seem to be answered. And I guess I'm going to do a disclaimer right at the beginning of this and tell you that by the time I get through sharing with you this morning, I'm not going to be telling you how prayer works because I don't know how prayer works. You see, prayer is one of those God things. And honestly, I don't think we need to know how it works. We just need to have faith and know that it does. So, having said that, let's talk about our prayer. We struggle as human beings with the idea and concept of prayer, especially if we feel as though God is ignoring us or not answering our prayers. Because generally when we tend to offer prayers that we particularly want an answer for, it's because we're having some trial or we're having some struggle or something's not going right, and so we're seeking some sort of fix. We want God to fix it and make it better, or fix it and make it right, whatever it is that's going on. And so the first scripture that was read for you this morning is Jesus' words concerning prayer, not all the words he ever spoke about prayer, but some of them spoke about prayer. And we're going to look at that, and then we're also, I'm going to talk just a little bit about the second scripture that was read about Paul and how Paul's unanswered prayer affected him. So, in large part, our expectations about prayer are shaped, of course, through scriptures that we read, and the one that was shared from Matthew is one that such scripture that we often look to and we point to and says, well, it says right here, if you ask these things with faith, then you can move mountains. And then we wonder, well, if that's what Jesus said, then why is it that my prayers don't seem to have any effect? But we need to remember that when we pray, that there's certain things that go into effect, and that I'm going to get into those in a moment. When we read promises like that from Jesus in the scripture, and we ask for prayers for a dying friend, or prayers for a job to open up, or prayers for our children to be safe, and it doesn't seem as if those prayers are answered, we often place the blame for that unanswered prayer on the person who is praying. We say to ourselves, or someone will say, well, you need to pray harder, or you need to pray more, or you need more people to pray, and the more people that pray, then that's when prayers are going to be answered. And I think that we we have a misconception about how that works. There's even such a worry and a concern about why our prayers aren't answered that you can go online, and if you type in, "Why are my prayers not answered?" there are places you can go that will explain to you why your prayers haven't been answered. It's true. And I found one, and here's some of the things. This is just a few of the reasons that this website tells you if your prayers are not being answered, why. You are not seeking to please God. You have unconfessed sin in your life. You pray with improper motives, or you lack faith. Now, that's just some of the reasons why they say that your prayers are not being answered. But I think to say that that God would have answered your prayers for this sick or dying friend more completely if you had been living a better life, if you hadn't got sin in your life, or if you're praying for more proper motives. I don't know what better motive you can have than praying for someone to be made well, but I think it's silly for us to think that these conditions are put on our prayers that we offer to God, because I don't believe that God puts conditions on our prayers. We would never be holy enough to pray if that were the case. And there's examples in the New Testament all the time of people asking for and receiving healing that did not do anything other than ask to be healed in order for that to happen. If God or Jesus had waited for those people to get into a right frame of mind or become holy or whatever before he healed them, there'd be a whole lot less stories in our New Testament about Jesus and the miracles that he performed. Now, I'm not suggesting that we don't need to live a good life and try to do things that please God, but to try to imagine that God answers our prayers based on our quality of praying or on our worthiness of prayer seems to be counterintuitive if we say we believe in God's grace. Because when we say we believe in God's grace, then we're saying that our works don't save us, but God's grace does. So the idea that we can pray more or harder or with better words, that will get our prayers answered, is something that we need to get beyond, because that's not how it works. I believe that prayer is something that we do to put us in a frame of mind to be able to hear God's presence and God's words for us. Because if you look at what we do with prayer, prayer takes us out of ourselves and puts us into thinking that there is something more out there than what we understand. So I don't think unfulfilled prayer is a result of our failure in any way. And if it's not a part of our failure or our lack when our prayers don't seem to be answered, then we have to ask ourselves, okay, so why is it then, again, that prayers are not answered? Well, first I want to look at the first scripture this morning briefly and look at it and say that when Jesus said these words about being able to move a mountain if you just pray with faith and sincerity, that Jesus was using a way of speaking that we use still today. It's called hyperbole. And you know what hyperbole is? Hyperbole is making a point in such a way that it's so outlandish that it gets your attention. And so that's what Jesus was doing. It was the language of the prophets. It was the language of the first century teachers in Jesus' time. And so the problem becomes when we look at scripture, especially this particular one, that we look at it and we want to read Jesus' words hyper-literally when we need to read them hyperbolically. Because Jesus wanted to make a point. He wanted to rattle people. He wanted them to be shocked into thinking differently than the way that they thought. And so Jesus used examples. He used hyperbole to shake them out of their common way of thinking, to think in a different way, to move them beyond their complacency to make change. And so there are other examples of Jesus using hyperbole when he told his stories. Maybe you remember that there's a place in the New Testament where Jesus says, "If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out." Anybody here want to do that? I'm thinking would there be a whole lot of handless, eyeless people around. No, Jesus didn't we were supposed to literally cut our hand off or poke our eye out. Jesus was saying that sin in your life is serious business, and when you don't take care of it, it can overtake and ruin your life. It would be the same as if you cut off your hand or you poked out an eye. Imagine how less likely you would be to be able to find employment or get along in the community. So you can see Jesus was not saying to do this literally. He was making a point in an exaggerated way about the evil of sin. And then another one that's often used is when Jesus says that it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone rich to enter the kingdom of God. Again, there's been a lot of writings from lots of biblical scholars about what this means and what reference he was making. But I'm going to say that in my mind, Jesus is just making a point in an obscure, ridiculous way so that people would listen to the rest of what he has to say. That's how you get people's attention. It's a hook. And so Jesus didn't mean this literally. He didn't mean, no, there's no way you're going to get, okay, a camel and a needle, eye needle. Okay, it's ridiculous. But what Jesus is saying instead is that if you let your wealth become your God, then it's going to have a devastating impact upon your life and your soul. Because you're not going to be able to do anything other than worship that money, and that's going to keep you from getting into heaven. So you see, Jesus was using hyperbole. He didn't intend for them then or us now to take things that he said like that literally. And so when Jesus says in the scripture that was read today, whatever you ask for in prayer with faith, you will receive, I still don't believe that Jesus intended for us to take that literally. I do think that he's trying to encourage the people that were listening that day and still for us today that we need to think clearly about how important prayer is in our lives and that we need to make sure that we understand that God is with us and God hears our prayers. We still use hyperbole today. I've heard people say, I'm so hungry I could eat a horse. We don't do that much. And I think then we need to think about, okay, maybe Jesus had some other kind of, he was trying to make a point in a different kind of way, rather than saying literally, you can make a mountain move. I think that Jesus, the people listening to Jesus that day understood what he was getting at. That they understood that he was speaking hyperbolically. Because I don't believe that what Jesus was saying is that when you pray, and if you pray with faith, that, it's going to be like you have a magic wand or a genie in a bottle, where if you pray for wealth, poof, you get lots of money raining from heaven, or if you pray that suddenly you wake up in the morning and you're not in captivity anymore, that that's going to happen. I don't believe that's what Jesus was saying, because I think he was meaning it in a more cryptic, even more dangerous kind of way, if you will. Because there's nothing in there that says that we can pray with faith and that our challenges, our disappointments, our illnesses, our every desire of our heart is going to be granted. Because that's not what prayer is about. I think what maybe they understood Jesus was saying was that you need to take your concerns and your burdens to God. And that you need to be bold when you pray. And that you do need to ask God to make sure that you have the things that you need. And that then you trust God, that God will hear those prayers. And when you do that, you're going to maybe not understand how God has answered or is answering your prayers, but that you know that God is there helping you get through them. Now that's a lot to take in to that little bit of scripture. But I do believe that we need to be careful when we think that we can magically pray and make things happen at the snap of a finger. But we humans, we really do, in some cases, want to take Jesus' words literally. We want to be able to ask God to do something and have it done as soon as we ask. Don't we? You'd say, well, what's the problem with that? Of course I do. But what would the world world look like if prayer worked that way? What if by faith you prayed sincerely in the name of Jesus that you wanted a certain person to ask you out on a date, let's say? Do you think God would force that person to go out on that date if they didn't really want to, simply because you prayed to have it happen? Would you want to live in a world where you were forced to do something because someone else prayed that you would? And then you say, well, what if I pray not for myself but for somebody else? Isn't that a better way to pray? And I think that, yes, it's a good way to pray, and yes, it's important that we pray for others, but we have to remember that praying that someone's illnesses be cured or disappeared would then obscure the laws of nature that God has put into place, and we'd go back to that, like last week, if that could happen through prayer, we wouldn't need doctors or medical researchers or hospitals. And God doesn't work that way. God will not intervene in the natural course of events like that. God gave us human bodies that we have to take care of. And I think God intends for us to be purposeful in our prayer. But somehow I don't think that means that God and Jesus means that we can just simply pray for something and have it happen, as if we for a moment become God, because that's essentially what we're trying to do when we pray and expect God to do what we pray for. So that is how we look at this particular scripture and how we might view and think about prayer and how we wish prayer might be. And how we continue, though, I haven't answered any questions about why our prayers are not unanswered, but let me offer an example of prayers that are unanswered, and one of them was in the scripture that was read to you this morning from Paul in his writings to the church in Corinth. Paul says he's been given a thorn in his flesh, and he says that he's been given that so that he won't boast so much about all the good stuff that's going on. And he's suggesting that this thorn or this affliction, whatever it is that's upon him, has come as a messenger from Satan. Now, there's some speculation about what this affliction was. Some say it was maybe it was macular degeneration, condition, you know, that causes you not to be able to see well. And that perhaps in this case, Paul was talking about healing for his eyes. But no matter how it is that Paul explains what it is that's causing this problem in his life, he says that he prayed three times and asked God to relieve him of this illness. And the answer that he received from God was that my grace is sufficient for you. And I want to say, what kind of an answer is that? Paul wanted comfort. But if you look at the next lines that follow, Paul found comfort in those words. Paul found comfort in understanding and hearing God say, my grace is sufficient for you. Live into that grace. So God didn't heal him, but God helped him to deal with the thing that he was struggling with. So God used Paul's weakness to instill in him a sense of purpose that went beyond what Paul could understand, even if he maybe had been healed of this thorn that was in him. Because Paul writes that he began to see every insult, disaster, and stressful situation in his life as an opportunity for God to do good through him. Now, I'm not saying that I want to pray and have God say, well, just deal with it. Because I don't think that's exactly what God does. But I do think that when we ask for healing, that sometimes we really mean we want a cure. And we need to remember that when we ask for healing, healing comes in all shapes and sizes. So when our prayers are unanswered, they should at the very least teach us that God doesn't always answer our prayers in the way that we want them answered. And so sometimes when we think God is not answering us, God is answering us, and God is simply saying no. Or God is saying, you need to wait. Or God is saying, you need to pray for something else. Because unanswered prayers, I think, teach us that while God does not maybe answer our prayers the way that we want them, I believe that God does not abandon us or leave us on our own. And Paul is an example of his understanding that even in the midst of his distress, that God's grace was sufficient. Let me just remind you that last week we talked about evil in the world and those kinds of things, and I still want to remind us that even in this idea of why our prayers are not answered, that I still want us to remember that it is not God's will that evil occur. It is not God's will that death of innocent children happen, and God does not will suffering in the world, but in a world where there is going to be suffering and tragedy, God uses those things to motivate and to help us understand God's presence, and more importantly, to help us understand that we have been placed here to be the answer to those prayers that are offered for healing and wholeness. We remember last week I said God gave humans dominion. That means caretaker over the world. And that means that we're supposed to take care of everything that's on it and around it and of it. And that means that we are called to take care of each other, each other's needs. So I think that it's the same as understanding that God placed humans to take care of the earth, that God works through us so that when things happen that need to be remedied, we are the ones who answer that call. We are the ones who answer those prayers. I don't believe that God will suspend the laws of nature so that things can happen in a way that's not part of that nature that God created, those natural laws that God created the earth with. But I do think that that we don't need to discount that miracles do happen. That might come up in your questions about prayer. I think miracles do happen, and miracles by definition mean we don't know how they happen. We don't know what causes them to happen. But I do think that things happen in an extraordinary way many times. But that's not how God usually works. That's not how God usually answers prayers. God normally and most often works through people, calling us and nudging us into action, working in our hearts to get us to be the instruments then that God uses to be the answers to the prayers of others. I guess I can't say that enough. I believe that those intuitions, those moments when you think, oh, I should call that person, or I should go that direction instead of this, or I should do something different than what I'm thinking of doing, those are the moments, I believe, when God touches us and puts us into the place where we can then be an answer to prayer. How many times has that happened to you when you think of someone to call and you call or you run into somebody and you say, oh, I was just praying that something would happen. And there you are. That's not a coincidence, my friends. Our task is to pay attention and listen for the promptings of God's Holy Spirit, and then to be ready and present to act, to bless, and to care for, and to stand up for others. When a group goes to Africa and digs wells and builds schools and churches, they become the answer of the prayers of those people in that country to have a better life for their children. It's important for us to know that prayer is something that we need to do. Prayer is something that science, as I read to you before, science shows that prayer changes us. It changes the makeup of our body and our brain. And I think it also helps us to realize that God's intent for us isn't that we get to witness miracles every day, but that we get to see the most miraculous things happen in the most common of ways. We need to remember that God is not a divine vending machine. You don't get to slip in a prayer and out pops a miracle. It doesn't work like that. E. Stanley Jones, a theologian, put it this way. He said, if we throw out a boat hook from a boat and catch hold of the shore and pull, do you pull the shore to you? Or do you pull yourself toward the shore? See, prayer is like that. Prayer isn't about pulling God into our will, but prayer is about pulling ourselves toward God. And maybe when we pray over and over for something to happen, and it seems as if God isn't answering. And I said this before, but it won't hurt to say it again. Maybe God is just saying, there's something else out there you need to be praying about. And eventually, we need to stop praying for that thing and maybe stop asking, why isn't my prayer being answered? And instead ask, well, what now, God, do you want me to do? I believe with God's presence guiding us and directing us, we can become the prayers, the answers to the prayers of the world. Let me share with you a quote from World War II Admiral Chester Nimitz. This is about his experience of prayer over the course of his life, and maybe you've heard these words. I asked God for strength that I might achieve. I was made weak that I might learn humbly to obey. I asked for health that I might do greater things. I was given infirmity that I might do better things. I asked for riches that I might be happy, and I was given poverty that I might be wise. I asked for power that I might have the praise of men, and I was given weakness that I might feel the need of God. I asked for all things that I might enjoy life, and I was given life that I might enjoy all things. I got nothing that I asked for, but everything I hoped for. Almost despite myself, my unspoken prayers were answered. I, among all men, are most richly blessed. You see, I think that is the power and meaning of prayer.